Hello, I'm Nicholas Hyatt, Investment Manager here at Wealth Club, and today I'm with Malcolm Ferguson of Octopus Ventures to talk about the Octopus Titan VCT. Malcolm, for those who aren't familiar, could you tell us a little bit about Octopus Ventures and about yourself?
Yeah, of course. Octopus Ventures has been around since 2007. We're best known for managing the Octopus Titan VCT, which today is the biggest VCT in the UK market. I've been with Octopus for 10 years now. I'm a partner and the lead fund manager on the fund. Before Octopus, I worked in the investment banking industry for 5 years, firstly at Bank of America Merrill Lynch, and then at a technology boutique called GP Bullhand.
And what is it that the Octopus Titan VCT aims to do for investors?
So Octopus Titan VCT aims to offer venture capital exposure to retail investors. Like, that's an asset class that's historically been available only for institutions, pension funds, insurance companies. If you're very lucky to have a family office, you can invest in venture capital. But through Titan VCT, retail investors can get exposure to that. So we invest in 15 to 30 new early stage companies a year. We have a portfolio of over 140 companies. So as a new investor to Titan, you get exposure to that full portfolio of 140 companies. What we aim to deliver to our investors, we aim to deliver capital appreciation through NAV growth and income through dividends. And we pay a 5% dividend. And if there's particularly large exits in a year, we may pay special dividends on top.
So what sorts of companies do you aim to invest in through the VCT? And is there anything that you particularly look to avoid?
So we look to invest in UK-based seed and Series A companies. For people who don't know what that label means, a seed stage company is a team of 4 or 5 people with an early product through to Series A, which is a bigger team with maybe $1 million of revenue, and they're looking to develop what's called product market fit. So when we invest, we're investing at a point where they're looking to then scale up from that point. What we're looking for is this needle in a haystack. There's this combination of factors that's really kind of rare to find. At its core, we need talented, ambitious founding teams. And these are people who are relentless, resilient, driven, passionate, magnetic, these really special individuals that can basically pull people in and get them to join them on their journey. They're generally operating in huge markets. So these are markets that won't constrain the size of that business because there's so much room to build something great. They're also using cutting-edge technology. This is newest technologies like, for example, AI. And this gives them advantage against incumbents who are usually profitable, led by great people who have lots of trust. How can you beat them by using the greatest technology? If you can do those things combined, those businesses can grow incredibly rapidly. And if successful, can become multi-billion pound household names. That's what we're looking to find.
So can you give us a couple of examples of those seed or Series A companies that you've backed recently?
Yeah, so we've invested in about 60 companies in the last 2 years. So a high volume of opportunities. We're able to do that because of the size of our team. We have 32 people on the investment team currently. So I'll pull out a couple of examples just to give some color around that. The first business I'll touch on is a company called Automata. So they are a collaborative robotics company. Collaborative robotics means a robot that can sit alongside humans safely. And they've chosen a focus area, which is lab automation. So their robotic arm sits in this lab workbench. It comes along with some workflow management software. And it can essentially take away all the really boring, repetitive, manual tasks that a clinician would generally have to do. It makes them more efficient, better output, makes their job more enjoyable. It means they can focus on the most value-added services. We first met that company back in 2017, and we only invested in 2022. So we actually followed it for 5 years before we invested. At that point, we'd seen they had the right ingredients of things that we were looking for. Since then, in fact, last month, September 2023, the company announced a $40 million growth round to help double down on the success that they've had. They have customers including the Francis Crick Institute, AstraZeneca, Novartis, even the NHS. So they're getting some really interesting market pickup. Another company is at a different end of the spectrum, which is a company called Unlikely AI. You can probably guess by the second half of that name, it's an AI business. It's founded by an individual that we'd backed previously. His previous company was called EV Technologies, which we then sold to Amazon. And that became the foundation upon which Alexa was built. So he led that team for a period of years. He then left. This is his next business. What Unlikely AI are trying to do is they're trying to fix the deficiencies that exist within what's called large language models. This is a term to describe things like ChatGPT, which may be more common for most people to have understood. These things are arguably going to be the next platform shift. We have the internet, we have the mobile, we have generative AI through these models. But they have one really big problem, in that they hallucinate. Hallucination means they make something up in such a convincing way that you believe it. So that's ordinary, doesn't matter too much. If you write a blog post that's not quite right, that's okay. But for some applications, that's very dangerous. And what he's trying to do with his business is make them more reliable, more safe, but most importantly, more explainable. So that basically unlocks that for hopefully a much broader set of use cases. And the final one I'll touch on is one from our consumer vertical, but it's also a deep tech business. So it's a bit of a combination of both. It's a company called Partly. So Partly connects car part buyers with car part suppliers. And that sounds like a simple thing to do, but there are tens of thousands of different car brands or like versions, models. There are 50 million plus parts. There are 20,000 plus suppliers. So if you would go onto eBay and say, put your car, age, brand, name, model, etc., you'll get hundreds of parts. Most of them won't fit. If you use the Partly technology, you'll have four, they'll all fit. So it means the customer experience is brilliant. It's better for the sellers who don't have to keep selling and returning products. And it just completely changes how that part of the industry works.
They all sound really exciting, but what about the more established holdings in the portfolio, the ones that have been in there for a while? How are they doing?
So we have 140 companies. 80 of those have been in the portfolio for more than 2 years. I'll pull a couple of examples out here. So Skin and Me, which is our second largest company in the portfolio today. This is a direct-to-consumer skincare business. But it's not just any skincare business. They have prescribers, physicians, and dermatologists on their payroll who can then essentially create these bespoke mixtures of products, prescription-grade products that can treat things like acne or rosacea. And the beauty is, it's different for everyone, and it changes every month as your skin changes. They have over 5,000 five-star reviews on Trustpilot, and they're just adored by their customers. Another company is out of our health pod, which is called Pelago Health. It used to be called Quit Genius, and it was started by three doctors who observed this pervasive problem in their clinics, which was addiction. They saw people addicted to alcohol, to tobacco, to opioids, and they thought, there's got to be a better way. The people were actually stigmatized into fear and inaction, so they weren't doing anything, or they were trying treatments which just weren't working. So they left their jobs, they created Pelago Health, which is a digital clinic for substance use management. So they combine the best digital health tools with cognitive behavioral therapy and medical assisted treatments. Today they've treated almost 1 million people. They have raised over $75 million in funding to do so. They have an incredibly fast momentum in the US market, which has a problem of opioid addiction and much more extreme than in the UK. And they're really making a big impact on solving that issue. Another company to touch on is a company called Vitesse. So Vitesse is in our fintech pod. And this is a business that we backed back in 2020. We actually issued the term sheet in the first lockdown of COVID, which was quite an interesting time to be making investments. And this was a team who had initially built a payments business, which they'd sold to Worldpay and worked at that business for a number of years. They got sick of working at the big business and wanted to start again. And this is a business that offers treasury and payments services to big insurance companies. They essentially help those insurance companies pay out claims more quickly, more efficiently, and more cheaply. They had this really big win since our investment. They were selected by Lloyd's of London to be their provider of this new initiative called the Faster Claims Payment Initiative, which is part of their modernization reforms. So they're being selected by some of these really big stakeholders to help just make this whole market much more efficient.
Great young companies like those have lots of people looking to give them money. So what beyond funding do you offer for your investees?
That's spot on. The really frustrating thing is we see 3,000 businesses, we find the best 15 to 30, and then we're fighting with the other funds to back those. So the fact that we have a big brand as Octopus Ventures is really helpful. We're also delivering our expertise through specialist network knowledge and experience through the specialist sector teams. But the reason beyond funding people choose us is really around two things. And to find those two things, we experimented with tens and tens of different initiatives. What would be useful? What would they enjoy? Get some feedback from the founders. In the end, two things really stood out. Firstly, is the quality and the success of a company is determined almost like completely by the quality of that founding team and the quality of the people they can surround themselves with. If that you get that bit right, that's half the battle. So we have six people on our people and talent team who are hired from some of the big successful scale-up companies, checkout.com, DeepMind, Google. So we've got some really impressive people who then help our companies do a variety of different things. One, get amazing talent in the door. Two, help that talent upskill through learning and development. Three, help them stay through employee experience. And then four, just getting the basics of process, HR information system, policies, what do you pay your CFO? These types of questions they can help with. So that's on the people side. The next challenge for a company, once it's got amazing people, is how do you raise your next round? So we help them, we're still on the board of the companies, we help them set the right milestones. What do you need to deliver to be able to raise more money? We help make introductions to other later stage funds, and we may even continue to invest further going forward.
The VCT's been through a tough time in terms of performance recently, I think it's fair to say. What's behind that?
Yeah, so we came out of a 14-year bull market cycle, which ended at the end of 2021. And the thing that ended that was high inflation levels driving interest rates up. And interest rates are quite impactful for the technology industry in terms of how companies are valued. So what we saw after the end of 2021 was essentially a resetting of how technology companies were valued. One sub-vertical within technology, which has a lot of data points in the public markets, are software as a service companies. They went from being worth 18 times median revenue to being 6 times revenue. So that identical company is worth a third of what it was. We then saw how does that translate into the private markets, and the later stage the companies were, the more impacted they were. So we saw Series D stage companies fall by as much as 60%, through to Series A stage companies maybe fall by about 30%. So when we have all these data points and when we're essentially pricing our portfolio, what's the fair value of the portfolio, we have to reflect a lot of these examples. So we saw a lot of the downside pressure in our net asset value over the last 18 months was a result of the resetting of how technology companies have been valued. On the positive side, since the second half of 2022, valuations have largely stabilized and are starting to rebound a little bit. So I feel like we're through that transition period now, and we can start to build on that. The other dynamic we've seen in the market is there's been a reduction in the amount of capital availability. So that's led to what I would call funding scarcity. Funding scarcity means companies need to be much more efficient, try to get to profitability if they can. But if they can't, then they have to essentially go into administration. So there's marginally more than that than would normally be the case. But what I would say in these tough environments, they always create really interesting opportunities. Venture capitalists love these reset markets because new things become available. The first things we're seeing are, I touched about Series A valuations being 30% less. We're seeing less competition for rounds, so we're more likely to win in those really competitive opportunities. The prices are lower. And post-investment, there's three things that have happened in the market. Firstly, you have more talent availability. That's because there's actually been over 300,000 redundancies in the tech industry in 23 alone. The big tech companies essentially have reduced their staff. The big growth stage companies that had raised big rounds trying to get to profitability, so they've shed staff as well. So these people that used to be impossible to hire, we can now hire them. And I touched on before how important talent is to drive the success of a company, so that's now available. Second piece, funding scarcity means less people get funded. So if we back a company, in 2021, six other people with the same idea would have also got funded, and then it'd be basically a bloodbath with people fighting for the same prize. That's not happening now. There's less people getting funded, so there's less competition. So your probability of success grows. And then the third piece, which is interesting how that will play out in the next few years, is the incumbents are retrenching. So they're no longer focusing on innovation. They're focusing on their core business to protect their EBITDA. But that creates these pockets of essentially untouched earth that these founders can fill and then build businesses within. And when those incumbents then realize they've kind of taken their eye off the ball for 2 or 3 years on innovation, they may look to start to fill those gaps, potentially through acquisitions of our portfolio.
So it sounds like the market has changed quite a lot around you. Have you changed the way you invest at all, given that sort of change of environment?
So the investment landscape has evolved. I think the core piece we're seeing is there's less competition for new investments. Clearly, the very best founders will always raise money in any market environment. So we need to make sure we have our A game so that the best founders want to work with us. But the difference is when we're now investing in these companies, we're expecting and helping them have essentially more runway than they used to have. So historically, you would fund a business, they would have 18 months to prove out the hypothesis, and then they'd raise some more money to, again, if they were successful in proving out the hypothesis. Today, that time is 24 months or more. And also the strategies are much more focused. So instead of doing five or six different things, you really do one or two and do them incredibly well. So we're really reverting back, actually, not to a brand new market environment, but to what normal was in 2017, 18, 19. 2020, 21 were particularly probably outlier years driven by a lot of capital flooding in from international investors and all over the place.
Of course, it's risky investing in young companies. How many of those companies do you think will fail?
So I'll give you a sense of kind of the market, the industry statistics. How does that apply to us? And then why is it a bit different than Titan VCT? So the industry, about 50% of investments that are made will fail or lose money. There's only 20% of investments drive 80% of performance. So venture capital is very much driven by being in these outlier companies. The average company actually doesn't matter. Is do you get into the best company and is that able to grow and become a household name? That's venture capital as an asset class. Within Titan VCT, we invest in 15 to 30 new companies every year. And these are early stage, high risk, seed series A companies. We would expect a proportion of those to fail and a proportion of those, maybe a quite large proportion, but up to 50% we're quite comfortable with, but a small proportion, 20 or 30% of those to graduate into the next phase. That graduation means they prove the hypothesis, they raise more money at high valuations, and they try and scale. When I look at the Titan VCT portfolio, it's quite a mature, quite old portfolio now. We've been investing since 2008. It's 140 companies. So if I just break that down for you quickly, in this first bucket, which is pre-revenue and early revenue businesses, these are the really risky ones. That's about half of the number of companies, but only 20% of the value of the NAV. So actually 80% of the NAV doesn't sit in that bucket. But most of the companies do. These are the companies that hopefully become the next household name, the next Zoopla, but they are quite small level of exposure for us. If they're successful, they'll graduate from this bucket to what we call the early growth bucket. So that has between 1 and 10 million of revenue. They've proven product market fit, and they're now proving that they can build a replicable and repeatable business model. That makes up about a third of our companies and about a third of NAV. And then this last bucket are the big mature, later stage companies, more than 10 million revenue, maybe even 100 million of revenue. It's only 15% of our companies, but it's nearly 50% of the asset value. So although we're investing into lots of risky stuff, the portfolio itself has a lot of young companies in, actually the underlying NAV, almost 80% of the NAV, it sits in companies with more than a million of revenue, actually half of more than 10. So the dynamic's a bit different.
And on a more positive note, any exits recently that you can tell us about?
So the exits environment has been very different in 2023 versus the prior 2 years and before. To give you a sense, we are, as an industry, we're at about 5% of 2021 numbers.
And we're probably, in terms of exits?
In terms of exits. So there was 95% less exits than there were in 2021 and about 70% less exits than in 2022. So that number was lower. Within our own portfolio, we've seen that dynamic play out similarly, so there's less big exits that we'd normally see. There are smaller ones that are happening about around the edges. We were quite fortunate in selling a company called Wave Optics in 2021, which was actually sold in two tranches. So we got our first exit payment in 2021, the second one 2 years later this year, which meant we had sufficient exit proceeds to cover our dividends for the year, hopefully.
On the subject of dividends, you've recently changed your dividend policy. Could you talk us through what was behind that decision?
Of course. So to kind of set the scene a little bit, historically we've had a 5p per annum dividend policy, which we've hit since we set that target. It's been more than 5 or 6 years since we set that target. That was in the context of having about 100p NAV, so about 5% dividend yield, which was in line with what we were aiming to achieve. With the resetting of the technology valuations and the fall of our NAV, that pushed the dividend yield up to 7%, which we felt was too high. We wanted the capital to be investing into new investments and follow-on investments rather than leaving in the form of dividends. And so we adjusted the policy to set it at 5%. That means as the NAV grows, the dividend grows, but it means we can be more predictable there. And so that was the decision behind moving that. The other reason is we have a long-term target of having a net asset value of between 90 and 100p. And by having a slightly smaller dividend payout means we can more quickly get to that point. For investors that want more liquidity than our dividend target, they can achieve that through selling their shares through a share buyback process anyway.
So, Malcolm, to sum up, if I'm thinking about investing in a VCT this tax year, why should it be Octopus Titan?
So there's probably three core things to take away. Firstly, we are the largest VCT in the market, and scale brings big benefits in terms of being able to be selected by those best founders. We have the brand and the awareness and the scale of team that can go out and find these opportunities. We're able to invest in our people and talent function, which means not only are we more likely to be selected, but after selection, we can help our companies be more successful. The second reason is that we are, looks like from the outside, for investors, we're a generalist fund, but because we have the scale, we're able to deliver that through specialist expertise. And we focus on these seven areas of interest that we essentially have the relevant network knowledge and experience to essentially find and select and be chosen by those best founders. So generalist delivered through specialist expertise. And the final one is the level of establishment. So if you're a new investor into Titan, you're investing into a pre-existing portfolio of 140 companies, of which a large proportion of those have material revenues and are in scaling up phase. We're in a particularly interesting time now in that we have the same great companies as we had 2 years ago, but the asset value is now lower. So there's an opportunity to essentially be invested into those same companies, but at a different entry price.
Malcolm Ferguson of Octopus Ventures, thank you very much. If you're watching on YouTube, please press like and subscribe to the channel for more.